from the nation's capital, this is the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast with your host, Rob Snowhite.
This is episode 211 of the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. This episode is what happens when Sam Looper of Looper Flies is in your neighborhood and you invite him over for Taco Wednesday. We explain that in the podcast. And he's got a custom fly order to finish up, so we come down to my office after dinner. We set up his vise and we record the conversation while he finishes up his order, while he's also doing either Instagram or Facebook live event. In this podcast, we're going to talk about tips and techniques for tying poppers. We're going to discuss scissors, bourbon, Copic pens, and our favorite types of cheeses. So this is episode 211, featuring Sam Looper of Looper Flies. All right, we are live in the office here with Sam Looper, who just happened to be in town, dropped in for Taco Wednesday because my neighbors, whose kitchen is being reconstructed, have nowhere to eat. So I invited them over and we did Taco Wednesday because they were busy yesterday. So Sam is tying up a order of poppers, and you want to talk about what you're tying, what you're tying with, who these are for, etc.
Sure. These are some of the double barrel poppers from Flyman. I'm also live on Instagram at the moment. So if y'all want to watch, check it out. For those on Instagram, I'm here with Rob Snowhite and the Fly Fishing Consultant, ladies and gentlemen, the one and only. We're just doing some poppers, man. These are a little different from your traditional poppers. I'm sure. I mean, they're not new to the market now at this point. They've been out for a couple of years,
right?
But they're squishy, and that, I guess, injection process they use to make these kind of makes them a little different, a little bit more durable. Being that they're different, painting them, like I've found, like with traditional acrylics and things, doesn't quite work because of whatever it's made of versus the Dremeled or the traditional popper bodies that have, like, they made them on a lathe, right?
Right, balsa? Right?
Well, no, the foam ones.
Okay.
Like Rainies and things. Those are all made on a lathe.
Right, clean cell foam.
Yeah, yeah, and then they just machine them down to the shape they want.
This is an injection. It's
right,
like a mold.
Right. It's like traditional lure making even. You got a shape, you pump the plastic in, it's a soft plastic. It's almost that kind of, I'm thinking that's the way to do it. I really don't know. But I don't know. They're cool. They have eye sockets.
Any reason you're tying on whiteheads?
It's easier to paint. These I've got to do a chartreuse in white, I've got to do a yellow in white, and then I have to do the mullet, which is like a gray and then an orange face.
Mullet, the fish, not the hairdo.
Man, we party in the front? No, in the back. We party all the time. yep, the fish. I call it a mullet. It's kind of a gray and a, I don't know.
So I learned a trick for you tonight. You pre-wrapped the popper shank with thread.
Correct.
Why'd you do that?
So, because of this foam, I found that if you don't, and really any foam, I can't get this thing on here.
And you, I noticed your point is not sticking out, so if you slip.
Oh, it's going to hurt so bad.
Yeah.
I'm
almost there.
I've
gone to the ER for doing that before.
Have you really?
Yeah, the hook point.
Because you buried it. Nah, we'll just pull it out, man. Yeah, we're tough. So,
it keeps it from rotating.
Right, that's it. All right, you asked me about the thread, why I prep my thread, the hooks and the thread. So, and I actually learned this from Blaine. He was talking about glue one day and how glue, specifically specific types of CA glue, like Zappa Gap or in this case is Loctite, they will literally create a chemical weld to the metal. But you need something for that chemical to soak up to, right?
There are certain glues that will dissolve foam.
I mean,
so it's just dissolving and gluing it to itself.
Well, there's the foam is dissolving, but I'm also finding that it's welding the thread to the hook, and the thread is also welding to the foam. All right, because the foam doesn't weld to the metal very well, but this is gel spun, and that's what adheres to the metal. Right, but it also adheres to the foam. The foam and the metal don't adhere very well.
I've learned that, right?
Because you're spin. Right. So eventually you're rotating. But if you dress it, another trick, and I saw Scott Lewis do this, is he will take McFly foam, like egg foam,
right?
And he'll wrap it in underneath this thread as an even more sponge material to soak up the glue. And really, man, it's kind of indestructible because he's tying these big foam things, you know, big foam wiggle minnows and stuff that's like this. So he can't have that foam rotate. So he'll dress the whole hook with McFly foam and gel spun and then put his glue over that. I've tried to do it with the Zap foam glue,
mm-hmm.
and it didn't work, which is bizarre because it's the point of this stuff is foam glue.
BSI Industries, Bob Smith Industries, makes a glue that does not dissolve foam.
Okay.
I used to get it up here at our hobby store, which is now vacant. Hmm. The rent here is a little crazy, so we're starting to get a lot of vacancies.
I can imagine.
A little culture shock with things up here.
Is it?
Traffic was fun, right?
Not at all. I had to go 12 miles, and it took 40 minutes. I sat for 4 minutes at a light.
Yeah.
4 minutes. I had enough time that I could go through Instagram until I got back to what I'd looked at about an hour before. I was like, oh, I already saw this.
Is the only reason I ever leave here at rush hour is to go to Beer Tie. Or
it was awful.
Yeah, there's no other reason. I don't really drive anywhere in the afternoons here.
All right, I got a ton. All right, so Hankley and Pat Kelly Fishing. Talked about gel spun. Hankley says it's because the gel spun is polypropylene based. And that's kind of what I was saying about earlier with the plastics and melting. And then somebody else said chemical, I believe it's in a certain, I guess, glues that creates a weld. Yeah, that's what Blaine was saying, was like it welds. It's a plastic weld because once whatever chemical reacts with this stuff, as it dries and reacts with oxygen in the air, that's the what's making it adhere or weld.
So what's the next step once you get all these heads lined up?
We're gonna spray paint them with Copic, my airbrush stuff. I just use the Copic gun. I've got a compressor I use because it's cheaper than buying the canned air. I can go through the canned air pretty quick. I know they say it's not much, but I mean, if you take an entire white foam body and you need that to be a new color, you can use up some air. But that little guy was like $60 at Amazon, and then I bought the tube and the quick release kit for it, so maybe under $100 for the compressor. And then it's done.
Start doing some parking lot tattoos next.
Yeah, you know. Looper's ink. Looper ink. Yep, somebody else said they use Ultra Chanel. Same idea. And it's some other sponge to soak up the glue and just kind of make it a little bit more heavy. I mean, eventually you're going to defeat if you put too much, obviously. If it gets... You would defeat that weld because you're just...
You don't want anything that's going to soak up water, too, and like...
Exactly.
Sinking it down.
Yep. And, I mean, these things are made to be eaten by another creature. They're not going to last forever. They're going to last a long time, but they're not going to last forever. That's all. They might if you don't fish. 9 to 5 flies. Hey, how's it going? What's up?
How much super glue do you go through?
A lot. This is fresh.
Can you get those in bulk?
Hairline carries it. Loctite, yeah. Yep. Sorry, this is kind of tedious. So. There we go.
Let's see if the scuds have woken up.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Rob's got some scuds here in his tank, man. That's creepy. Lenoir City, North Carolina, man. You guys are going to get dumped on tomorrow. Right? Maybe the day after?
I was expecting we were going to be having a storm right now up here.
But I did too, man. I'll be honest. Slow. Yeah, it's not going to be here till like Friday or Saturday. Up here?
The last thing we need is more rain.
Yeah. Oh, no. Don't go anywhere. Get on there, dude. Sometimes I just...
What's your time frame before that glue sets?
That's gotta, like... Depends on how much I mess with it. If I just leave it like that, you know, a minute or so, 30 seconds... But once I start manipulating it and, like, stirring it up, get that oxygen to it.
Just feel like MacGyver with the bomb clock counting down.
All this is dry already on my finger. It doesn't take long. But I like the gel because it doesn't drip.
So if there's a bank robbery locally tonight and there's no fingerprints?
It wasn't me.
Okay.
High Point, North Carolina. Not looking forward to it. Y'all gonna get wet. Virginia Beach might dodge it. I am in Virginia at the moment at Rob Snowhite's dungeon. His grave. What do you call it? His red room? Is it 50 Shades of Rob?
Fly Time office. Podcast headquarters.
That's right. And
there's a rule about no barefoot in here, or no socks. Really? Only. There's so many random hooks in this carpet.
I bet.
I found a barbless black size 10 hook today.
Oh, man. My floor is a fake hardwood.
You gotta get one of these tie wheels.
You like?
Yeah. You drop things.
I just have two tables, like you've got, but they're big. I've got one here, and I have one that goes this way.
I need to repaint this one white.
I'm repainting it with glue right now.
That's fine.
Can't wait to get these things painted. We're close. I'm about to employ you to put these things together so I can start painting.
And the odd thing is, it's for a local guy.
Yeah, is it? Is he local?
Yeah. It's from my hometown.
Is he really?
Yeah.
He's from up here. Do you know him?
So I was like, ask his brother's name's Gordon.
Let's see if he's on here. Hang on. Conch Flies or something like that. I can't remember what he goes by. I'm sorry, man.
His last name's Wagner.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Yeah, he's listening. Conch Fly Fire 4, that's his name.
Ask if Gordon's his brother.
Hey, William, is Gordon your brother if you're still watching? There's only 10 people watching. I don't know if he's actually one of them.
I don't know how many Wagners there are from Ruston.
Yeah, he is not watching right now. Location. He is not currently viewing. That's okay. But yeah, he was looking earlier.
So.
I can't believe he's local. He's cheating.
Oh, they're so great.
The squigglies.
You've caught so many large bass on these this year.
Yeah.
These were from Michael's Craft Store. I bought 30 of them.
30 of them.
Years ago. I've never seen them again.
They were a dollar, I bet. Cheating. I like to fish with worms. What I also like about the gel is after I mash it onto the hook, I can twist it around a little bit and get it, and then it just sets because it's not squishy. Hey guys, wait on the Driftless. Hey everybody, I keep picking up my scissors out of habit. As soon as I put a hook in, I pick my scissors up.
Do you need any hackles?
Maybe. What you got?
The Crees are mine.
Nice, man.
Ooh, anything in there you like?
Let me see this thing.
These were a gift to me, so.
Were they really? From that dude? How about that?
No, from a friend.
Oh, man.
You can go through it later.
Yeah. I will go through that for sure.
There was a whole bird in here for a while.
Really?
Yeah, I think these are just the gingers. Yeah, look at the cream.
Oh, nice. That's cool. What do you use them for? Dries and nymphs and stuff, or what?
I don't tie dries, actually. I mean, I don't really trout fish. I do,
yeah.
You do urban warm water, just large bass stuff.
Really? And everything's blowing out right now.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. We've had more than 40 inches of rain this year.
So that's what some girl at this training was saying, man. She said that their normal Virginia rainfall average was like 45, and they've had 48 for the year.
Yeah, that was by August.
That's crazy.
It's been, usually we get maybe 1 to 2 floods above 6 feet.
Mm-hmm.
We just crested at Little Falls yesterday at 11 feet for probably the 7th or 8th time this year.
Wow. Wow. That's loads.
And then you get all these, you know, flash floods and runoff. So every time the fertilizer gets dumped on, you know, you try to fish lakes and ponds,
mm-hmm.
but all the stuff just keeps washing in there. So you're getting nutrient overloads and the lakes are turning into pea soup.
Yeah. Algae and all that, kind of like what they're having in Florida, huh?
Yeah. Yikes. It's been tough this year.
Send the rain up here, Pacific Northwest. I had a friend that was out there recently doing a bull trout trip.
I've never found a more aggressive fish than a bull trout.
Yeah. Never fished for them. Are they around where you're from?
No, I'm from here.
Where did you go after them?
Our friend lives on Lake Pendre in Idaho. And he drove me up some dirt road into the middle of nowhere. They're wild huckleberries.
Yeah.
We almost hit a moose. There weren't even seats in his car. He had to put lead in the tank. That's how old his truck was. We were sitting on bags of cocoa mulch. And they dropped me off at a parking lot campfire, and I was going to fish my way upstream. And they were going to park in the middle, hike upstream, and then they were going to hike downstream. And ideally, we would all meet in about 2 to 3 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up just catching cutthroat. Like every single cast on little foam Chernobyl ants.
Yeah.
And the stream's maybe 10 to 15 feet wide.
Right.
And this is the short story. There's a whole podcast about the full one. And I get to this pool, and there's a waterfall of maybe 3 feet, big plunge pool, and then it's 10 feet wide at the most. I'm fishing a 7'5" weight, and I brought one box of flies because I didn't know where I was fishing or what I was going to counter. So I've got 3 royal wolves, 3 parachute atoms, 3 eggs, 3 of these, 3s of that. And I've got 3 of my streamers. And I've got 3 hoppers, 3 Chernobyls. So I drift that Chernobyl over the big hole, nothing. And then I see a nose pop up. And I was like, okay. So I put on maybe a parachute atoms, nothing. I switch it out. His nose pops up. And I'm probably 30, 40 feet away. Try every dry fly, nothing. I get up there, I tie on. It's the only streamer I use for trout. It's called my bacon fly.
Mm-hmm.
Find one in here. And I put that on. I cast it in there, and this mouth opens up. I'm going to do this with my hands. Like this. And chomps on the fly. And I set the hook, and I 3-foot-long trout.
Really?
In a hole that in the Shenandoah Mountains maybe would have a 10-inch brook trout.
Yeah.
And this fish threw the hook, and I climbed down over this rock, and my heart's about to beat out of my chest. I check my whole rig. I rest the fish. I go back up there, and there were maybe 1 or 2 more.
Really?
I don't know. But
really?
I ended up hooking one, and it ended up being this just monster bull trout.
We gotta show it.
And it was super aggressive. And as I went upstream, there were no more cutthroat. It was all bull trout.
Oh, wow.
And I would throw my streamer. That's me holding it on my thighs because I couldn't hold it up.
Wow.
Let me see. That'll work.
You turn it to the side, you can kind of see, there it is. Good grief, that's huge.
So after catching that fish, I determined I don't need to fish any other streamers other than this bacon fly, which I devised to fish up on the little Juniata back in the early 2000s. And as I'd go upstream, I'd throw it in, and 7, 8, 9 fish, all in the 20 inches, were fighting each other.
Over that fly.
It was like throwing a steak to hungry dogs.
That's fun. That's super fun.
Yeah, those fish were aggressive. It's too bad you're not here when the water's fishable.
Man, that's okay. And then we would be podcasting. And Instagramming. Actually, that's the last one. Cool. Now we can color
airbrush
stuff. Yeah, girl.
All right, do I need to get out of your way for this?
No, you're fine. I'm just going to set my vise down because I don't really need it.
Do I need to wear a mask for this?
Nah, negative, man. You need to plug up that dealio over there for me.
All right, it's underneath you.
Cool. Here, just hand it to me. I'll
take just something. Unplug whichever light you prefer. I inherited those mops.
I did not buy those.
Oh, and yes, those are urine sample cups.
That's cool, man. No judgment.
Those are for when I do the beer tie. If they don't know what the materials are all hidden in, the next time we have a beer tie on the table, I can divide up the hooks, the beads, the feathers.
Nice.
They're free at the doctor's office.
Sure. What's that? You're concerned about your teenager? Actually, hit it in the open one right there. That'd be just fine. Because it's going to make a little noise.
All right, let's see how this comes out in a podcast form.
It's not loud. It's funny. All right, the dude wanted yellow. I bought these off eBay.
Little mesh?
Mm-hmm. Specifically for what we're doing. All right, he wanted yellow.
Make a homemade mosquito trap with that stuff. You get a box fan, duct tape it around the outside. Turn on your fan, the box fan,
uh-huh.
And when the mosquitoes get close to you, they get sucked into the fan.
And they're stuck.
And you spray them with rubbing alcohol. Homemade mosquito trap.
All right.
At Walmart, it's called Tool, T-H-U-L-E.
Can I give a piece of paper or something? I'm going to spray on this. Perfect. He has 6 yellers. I got it. He had 6 yellers in medium and 6 in large. Yep. So, man, you just take this mesh and, I mean, you know.
I wish I had seen you tie these before I taught this at the TPFR beer tie. Just about them rotating with the thread underneath.
That's right. You just got to put something underneath.
Are you concerned about that getting all over your hands?
Not at all. It will get all over my hands. I don't care.
How about that? You're not going to get arrested tonight.
What is it? What do you mean?
If your hands were glowing, it would look like you had some...
drugs, huh? We know about that.
Could we caught you red-handed? I used to watch CSI.
That's funny. So check this out. The glue hadn't dried. It turns red, I guess, or the ink turns red, the dye, if the glue isn't ready. So, whatever, but it won't hurt it.
Does it fade?
No, it's always red, for ever and ever.
Maybe that's the secret to making the fly
that's
so successful,
better.
Is
that's
that one red dot.
The red dot on the butt. It's a baboon popper.
Your fly is an estrus.
Outlandish stuff I can do in my free time. Okay.
Watch your bourbon.
You mean your glass? And it's tasty, brother. See? Oh, this one's screwed.
Am I distracting you?
No. I can get that off. No, I can't. That one's done. Alright, we'll not do the small ones right now. We're going to let them dry. We'll get the big ones out. I bet I can turn that into a mullet. I'll just paint over it. Big ones are in that box upstairs. I will be right back, y'all. Hold
on. All right.
Hang on.
This looks like a Star Trek weapon.
All right. I'm back.
Here's your blaster.
Thanks, man.
Set it for stun. Do you refill these pens yourself?
No, I just buy new. It's just cheaper. I mean, I just haven't tried to refill them. I'm sure you could. I know that they make refillable the things, you know? Thanks.
Indeed. How's your first taste of dry fly bourbon?
It's not bad, dude. It's pretty. It's got some sweet to it.
For a 101.
Uh-huh. It's good. You can't even see that hardly. The pattern. Yeah, you can. Maybe a little bit. Barely, right? It's yellow. Yeah. It's what he wanted. We can do it. We can do it. Mesh.
You haven't gotten your kids into manual labor yet?
Man, I have offered cash money if I, you know, cause, and both my kids are so talented when it comes to like arts and crafts, dude. My mom has got the entire second floor of their home.
Your pen out?
No, it's just, it's been exposed for too long. Like it's like it gets weird, right?
It coagulates?
Yeah. There it goes. That's the only thing about these Copic pens is they don't behave like paint.
Are you familiar with stained by Sharpie? Mm-mm. These are one of the only fabric pens you don't have to iron to make them.
Oh, really?
So they're great on the Ultra Suede, and you can draw pretty much anything else. I have to keep them out of my daughter's hands because she likes to color with them. Mm-hmm. But they only come in red, orange, green, chartreuse, purple, blue, black.
I use fabric stuff, like for the, I use the Tulip fabric spray. It's an actual aerosol can. And that's also how I color all my Mega Game Changers, those big SF blend flies. I color all that with the Tulip fabric paint. And it's just a dye. It's completely permanent. So once you hit it with the stuff, I mean, and you know, it doesn't take much either. It's straight up like done. Like just one little spritz and it's enough paint to really color those game changers.
So in your fly tying office,
yeah.
When people come over to your house, do they ever end up in there and ask
Oh, yeah.
What is the weirdest thing you can show them?
What the heck are you doing in here? Like, what is this place? Has Lindsay not left you yet? My wife's name is Lindsay.
No. My wife's Alana.
No, my wife's name is Lindsay, and people ask me,
oh, right.
Has Lindsay not left you yet?
Yeah.
What is going on up here?
What is the weirdest thing you have in there?
Oh, the weirdest thing.
I show them, I've got a skin coyote face with whiskers and eyelashes and everything.
I guess the pelts of whatever, right? I don't have anything that's, because I don't use a lot of dubbing. You know, so I don't have a lot of, like, hair's ear or hair's mask or anything like that. I don't do any traditional tying, so I don't have the head of the whatever with the golden pheasant thing.
Yeah.
But I don't even know.
Golden pheasant.
Something like that. But it's a head of a
bird. Right, dried out. Yeah. It's like head jerky.
Yeah, I don't have that.
Is our public bathroom... when we have guests over
is down here.
Across, yeah, so people, they come downstairs looking for the bathroom, they inevitably click on the light in here, and they're like, what the hell?
What is happening in here? Yeah. The second floor of my home, there's kind of two bonus rooms. There's one where, like, the kids watch TV. It's like the theater room or whatever. And then there's an adjacent room that's one step up. And the opening is, you know, it's... somebody clearly, whoever the previous owner was, did this. And it's just a bonus room that they made for their kid, whoever this child was. It was like her doll room. And it's big. Like, it's because it's this room that we're in now with a queen size bed in it and a beer fridge and in like shelves. And then there's another room just like it on an L shape going that way. And that's where all my desks are and all my, and the walls are lined with pegboard.
Right.
Or slot board. And it's people, there was a time where my wife was not happy about that. But now it's like, yeah, go upstairs, check it out. You know, it's kind of neat. It's,
Before we lived here, I used to have to tie at the kitchen table.
Oh, dude.
I was persona non grata, especially with Marabu.
The reason we sold our house and bought the one we're in now.
Your old one was haunted.
No. We had an ice storm, and my wife's a teacher, and we had one bathroom in this home. And it was built in like 1949 or 51 or something. Tiny, tiny little spot, right? And I had this huge order of flies to tie. And I camped out on the kitchen table for like 3 days because it was an ice storm and I couldn't go to work.
You're stuck.
She couldn't go to work. And the between the feathers and the sparkle all over the floor and the table, and the fact that my wife was brushing her teeth, and my son at the time, I don't know how he, what old he was, 4, 5, comes walking into the bathroom and hops down and takes a shit right next to her, and she's putting on her makeup. That was it. That was it. We found a new house within 2 weeks. Like, our house is on the market. We were out, you know, we're done. We were done. That was enough. She needed to put on her mascara without smelling turds. And who can blame her? Every time I put on my mascara, I don't want to smell turds. My hands will be yellow for about a week.
People are going to think you got jaundice.
Man, people wonder. People wonder. Oh, man. Come out with a bunch of stab marks in your fingers, and you're like, what is wrong with that kid? He's poked up.
All right, so for those who have not heard an interview with you before, where are you from?
I was born in South Carolina. And I've lived in Tennessee. Well, I've lived in South Carolina and Tennessee my whole life. So, as a child, I grew up in a town called Powdersville, South Carolina. And I probably lived there for 2 years with mom and dad. But that was, you know, back in the 80s. And it's just a little tiny community in South Carolina, south of Greenville. And dad worked for Lance, the cracker company. Like, Frito-Lay, but smaller.
Yeah, I know little packs.
Yep.
We can't get the buffalo.
Yeah, they bought by Snyder's now, so they.
Yeah, the buffalo cheese one. That Wegmans is no longer. I'm sending you Wegmans for bagels.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I'm bringing the wife bagels home from Washington. That's going to happen. We'll put these right here. Just to hang out.
Jalapeno cheese. There's a bacon and cheese and everything.
Oh, I like the everything.
They also have some nice Bialys.
Well, I don't know what that is.
It's like a closed bagel with no hole, but it's filled with grilled onions.
Really?
In the middle.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds illegal.
And a schmear of...
Schmear. I love that word. Schmear
some butter on there.
Because you know how to spell it, right?
It's like schmaltz.
I don't know how to spell it either.
I think I was the last generation, or probably the first generation, where schmaltz was not on the regular menu at our houses. It was just jars of chicken fat. My mom would just smear it.
Delicious.
On crackers.
Smear. Man, these markers go out so fast, I never know which one's good to go. I think this one's it. I think this one's okay.
So I love when they came out with those highlighters so you can see the side and know how much is left.
Yeah, how much is in it.
That's how much of a nerd I was in college.
That's good.
I'd go through highlighters.
Right, back to where I'm from. So I grew up in, I was born in South Carolina, and then we moved, dad got a job at corporate headquarters with Lance, moved up into management, so we moved to Charlotte, and we spent nine months there while he trained, and then we moved to Kingsport, Tennessee, and lived there for 11 years, and when I moved back to South Carolina, that's where I went for high school, because dad had to go back to corporate headquarters in Charlotte. and we didn't want to live in North Carolina because of state income tax. South Carolina, you don't have state income. No state income tax in South Carolina. So they moved back, worked in North Carolina, lived in South Carolina. Side note about taxes in South Carolina, I did not know this, but Dad explained this to me. So when you buy a car in South Carolina, or any vehicle, boat, anything, you pay your tax when you buy it. The following year, you pay taxes again on a depreciated value of that vehicle or car or boat or whatever you bought, motorhome, whatever. The following year, you do it again.
For each depreciation?
The Kelley Blue Book value is what you pay taxes on every stinking year.
We pay what's called the car tax.
You do it in Colorado, Virginia. Too, I think. It's crazy.
The governor, 95, he ran on abolishing the car tax. Jim Gilmore?
Mm-hmm.
He was going to abolish the car tax, and he got elected, and I still paid every year.
Politicians. But yeah, I couldn't believe that Dad was explaining it to me. I had no idea. Because in Tennessee, you don't do that. You pay your taxes once, you're done. That's it. Thanks for paying. Here's your product, whatever it is that you've bought. Now, you pay a wheel tax in the county you live in, and some sort of tax on, like, the exhaust or whatever. I think you pay that.
We have to do emissions inspections.
Yeah, you gotta do that. Can't you refill the Copics? Yes, you can refill the Copics, sir. I choose not to, because I go, honestly, what I do is I go to either Hobby Lobby or Michael's, and I get the coupon on my phone that's 40% off one item, and I'm like, man, I need a thing of glue and a Copic marker, and you get it for, instead of $7-something, it's $4-something, which is what wholesale prices are anyway on these suckers. And
we have AC Moore across the street. It's rather convenient.
Yeah, dude, I just buy the marker, man. It's just whatever. Yes, you can refill them. I don't use them that much, though. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going through them like an artist would.
Right.
I've got four of these of the same color, and I bet I've had all four of those pens for 3 years, you know? And I'll just be like, oh, shoot, this one's running low, and the next time I go to Hobby Lobby, I'm like, oh, yeah, I needed a chartreuse, and I'll pick up one. And that's why I have a tub full of the same colors, the same eight colors. I'm going to show up to this course tomorrow, and they're going to be like, what did you do? And I'm like, Ninja Turtles, man. We were Ninja Turtles. We were pretending to be Ninja Turtles.
Gangrene.
Uh-huh.
I was bit by
painted ourselves like Ninja Turtles.
I was bit by a politician.
I totally rolled downtown when I got here Monday night, man, and it is empty. Washington, D.C. at 8 p.m., 9 p.m.
Oh, yeah. Everyone's
ghost town, dude.
Yeah, certain
running
spots.
Our country is just gone.
You got to go up to the party neighborhoods, Adams Morgan. Adams Morgan's not what it used to be.
Mm.
Those were some very Those crazy
days,
bars.
Huh? Where'd you go to school? You went to school up here, yeah?
No, I went down to Mary Washington in Fredericksburg, right on the Rappahannock.
Okay.
But, yeah, Adams Morgan's been, you know, cleaned up. You got DuPont, H Street is pretty popular, U Street corridor. And my cousin's a restaurateur in D.C. He does fairly well. He's got numerous restaurants. Best pizza in the city.
Gotcha. We are losing people left and right. We got two.
Y'all going to sleep?
Watch. They're dying because I'm not showing them what I'm doing. I'm not done painting. I'll show you what I do after I paint.
All right, so when did you get into fly fishing?
All right, the first time I ever did it, I was a kid in Kingsport, and I didn't know what I was doing. And there's a local car dealer. The man has now passed away, and his son owns it. His son's my dad's age. He's in his 60s, like 50s, 60s. But this guy's name was Don Hill. All right, Don Hill owns, like, 8 major dealerships in the Tri-Cities area. Pontiac being, you know, all of them. Well, Don and it went to church with us, and so did his son Rick, and for whatever reason, they just loved me to death as a child. They just thought I hung the moon. Small little, you know, Tennessee town, Southern Baptist, you know. So community was real important. And one night, Don came over and brought us some trout that he had caught out of the Holston River above Eastman, which is a big chemical plant in Kingsport.
Tasty. Was he fishing at night?
Nope.
He's like, I can see them.
Nope. He was trout fishing with an 8-weight fiberglass rod because the trout below this tailwater are enormous. Like, you know, just really, really large. But he brought home this slab of meat, basically, for...
Like salmon size.
Yeah, fillet. stupid sized trout to eat. And my dad was like, where did you get this? How did you do this? And the next day, he had a Wright McGill. I still have it. It's a Wright McGill Eagle Claw fiberglass 8-weight.
Broom handle thick.
it's as thick as this can right. In the back, man.
Is it like Hershey's Brown?
Dude, it's
with
so,
orange wrap?
Yes, it's so hard to cast.
Charlie Brown colors.
Yeah, it's so bad. Oh, yep. But Dad had to have it, and we took it up to... we had some friends that had some property on the Holston in Virginia, in Gate City in Scott County. And they actually owned this part of the property where the river ran around it. Basically, their property looked like a sock. And the river came down. It was three brothers, and they were all my dad's age because it was their dad's property, and he split it up among the three of them. One of them had raised cows. One of them was a... game warden, and then one of them was a health inspector, and our friend was the health inspector, and he had three boys, and I was like in the middle of them. It was two older than me and one younger, and we just ran that side of the hill, you know. I lived there 11 years, so every summer we were up there every weekend, and we were floating in the river, and it was the warm water section. So
smallies
and red eye, or
Google eyes,
black bass, whatever you want to call them, rock bass, all that crap. But that was how I got into fly fishing the first time, and then I never did again until I was like 23, 24. I'd just been married. No, Lindsay was pregnant. So this would have been like 2006, maybe. And my buddy Adam got me back into it, who's now a guide in Winter Park in Colorado. And he was like, man, come try this out. And the TWRA government, the local wildlife in Tennessee, have a stocking program that they do in the winter. So they stock warm water streams with trout in the winter. Because
right
it's
down
so
the street
cold.
They do
the same thing here. Cool.
Put and take, I think that's called.
Yeah, they want you to take it out. They put it in there so that you will actually take it home with you.
Before it just suffocates in the heat.
Right. Well, dude, some of them make it out to the lakes.
So we have springs that come into one, and a guy brought in a picture to Orvis Tyson's with a 23-inch rainbow.
It's probably
that was
in
taken
the
out of
summer.
This creek.
Yeah,
yeah, it was in August
summer.
Last
yeah.
year.
Dude, they'll do it in the Stones River in Murfreesboro that runs into Percy Priest Lake, and they'll find them in the lake. Which is bananas, but sure enough, I can't believe they make it that far, because it's not a clean lake, you know, you can't live on it, but it's like, it's below a major landfill.
Yeah. Seasons the fish.
Yeah.
Tin cans.
Kind of rough.
This one tastes like old diapers. It's like that, you've got kids, you've played that, the gross
yeah, the beans
bean
game.
Boozled game.
Bean boozled, yes, it's so gross. This one's bio.
I got
I
ate the bio one. I was like, I'm done. And the neighborhood
earwax,
kids were like,
the earwax on mid.
They're like, I'll pay. One of the kids was like, I'll pay you $10. I was like, no, like 20. I'm like, uh-uh.
So this guy I fish with, I hope he sees this. His name's John Udy in East Tennessee. I don't know what this game was. But we're all right. So we're out there musky fishing, and one of them hangs the bottom and he pulls it up and it's a mussel. And it's alive. Like, crack it open, there's a mussel inside.
I got a big dead one right here.
Dude. So they look at each other and they start, like, saying numbers or something. Like, 3, 7, 4, 8. And the guy says, stop or something. And he's close enough to the number that it's a bet. You know, either you eat it or you don't. And sure enough, man, he scooped
that
thing.
A dead mussel?
No, it was alive.
Oh.
Out of the Oak Ridge, Tennessee nuclear runoff lake. This, I don't know what the lake this is. Hang on, I gotta think. Maybe Great Falls? No. Hang on.
So the clams in Columbus, Ohio are this big?
No, this thing was like this big. Oh. It is nasty. You don't want to eat that. Like, that's filtering. Toxic. Oh, yeah, it's filtering all kinds of gross stuff. He scoops out his knife.
He became an X-Man.
Dude, he spent an hour later, and he's like, oh, I still taste it. I still taste the aluminum. So nasty.
I had a muscle in my tank. It didn't last.
Too much. Is that Dr. Jones or your kid?
Here comes Dr. Jones. You notice you can't really hear him? He doesn't really have any toenails.
Does he not? Why not?
With the blizzards we had a couple... It was a while ago. Either the salt on the roads for the chemicals, or it was the freezing. And they kind of just slowly rotted and fell off.
Gross.
See, we can't hear him. He's got...
Nubbins.
Yeah, maybe three.
We need to put a jingle bell on his...
Oh, his collar makes too much noise at night when he walks up and down the stairs.
Yeah, I can't stand that. Dude, we had an old dog. She just went blind kind of out of nowhere, right? She'd run into stuff and hit her head hard on the wall a lot. And then she would just bark. 4 in the morning, 2 in the morning. She'd just get up and start. She was a beagle. Dog, she's sweet as pie. When it was time to go, it was like, that's enough.
This neighborhood loves the beagles.
I love beagles. I'm a fan of the beagles.
I'm gonna grab a cerveza. Do you want one?
I would love one. I'm parched, sir. I'm gonna talk all kinds of goodness on this podcast. Cheers, everybody. I like the bourbon. Tonight's podcast was brought to you by Dry Fly, Straight Bourbon 101. Age 3 years. Product of Washington State. My wife is going to see this.
I was expecting making Manhattans with that in the, what they call it, Dubonnet glasses.
Mm-hmm. You were a bartender at one point, yeah? Amateur bartender.
I worked at this restaurant in Fredericksburg, Virginia. If it was daytime, there were 3 employees, the chef. No, sorry, daytime was myself and the chef.
Mm-hmm.
I was everything front of house.
I got you.
So bartender, I had to learn a bar. My first day, someone asked for Tanqueray and tonic, and I didn't know what it was. And then my first Sunday, someone asked for a mimosa, and I didn't know what it was. This is before you could look it up on your phone. Google. There was no book.
No Googling.
And I went back to the... I was pretty sure a mimosa was orange juice and champagne.
Mm-hmm. It is, right?
But I didn't know if it was 50. So I was trying to ask, do you like it more champagne or do you like a little more orange juice? And I went back to ask the chef and she told me to piss off. She was a recovering alcoholic and she didn't want to talk about it.
Oh, my God.
I was like, okay. So I had to figure out all the stuff on my own. The first drink I learned how to make was an old-fashioned down there.
Yeah. I drank an old-fashioned because I saw Don Draper do it.
Okay, what's the movie? There's a 1960s movie. It's something, something, something world.
There's it's a mad world.
Hey, why don't you go fix some more old-fashions when they're flying the airplane?
Hmm. Yes, sir. Man, how many people do you think will see this thing?
I'm not sure. So I just buy them in green.
Really?
Yeah. The problem is when you hook a tree, or I should say a client hooks a tree.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sir.
Down in front.
Yeah.
What was I just saying before I... Yeah. Old fashioned.
Yep.
Okay, so everything I did, I was bartender, server, busboy, cash register... I did everything, including going around with like a little dustpan and cleaning off tables.
Yep.
It had 12 seats. Everything came in fresh from a farm that day. It was all cooked. And the owner was a former executive chef at the Pentagon.
Oh, wow.
For like the generals.
How about that?
They said they'd give me any recipe I wanted but the chicken stock. And everything was made fresh. We got chickens in, fresh chicken pot pie every day. There was the quiche of the day. That's fantastic. Good, everything was... full butter. There was no low calorie anything.
Did Dad told me to go eat at Ye Old Steak and Seafood
in Fredericksburg.
He said you need to go there if you're in town.
That place has been around for a long time.
Yeah, he said go get the bone-in prime rib. And he said it hangs off the plate.
Too bad you're not down there in April.
There we are.
Shad run.
Is it nuts?
Something like this.
Yeah. Oh, I remember, dude, when we were selling, you were selling shad flies like crazy, man.
Oh, my God. This year was so messed up.
Because of all the weird...
The rain.
Rain, yeah.
Just has not stopped. If I knew I had accidentally planted butternut squash in my backyard, I would have torn it up a long time ago.
Did you plant butternut squash?
I am mowing around this monstrous plant. I'm ready. If we lose power because somehow the hurricane comes up here, we're going to be eating butternut squash for weeks.
Oh, the butternut squash.
And you had some of the candied jalapenos.
They were delicious. They were taco night on a Wednesday. It's a thing, man.
That's what I ate every night before
taco
I met my wife.
Taco Tuesday.
We had a sink that overlooked the TV. So Ultimate Bachelor move, why need a plate? You can just make a burrito and eat over. Like make it on the cutting board and eat over the sink.
That's me. I feel like I'm talking about how much I piss off my wife, and I don't. She doesn't hate me, so I don't want to say that. But
my wife can't stand fish and talk.
That's a peeve. That's a peeve. But eating like drippy fruit, like a peach, orange, pear.
The sound of it.
And over the sink that's grounds for murder.
What, you know, people eat oranges in the shower so they don't get all sticky?
Do they? It's a whole thing. That's you, isn't it?
No.
Oranges in the shower.
My oranges are for old fashions.
That's oranges in the shower. There should be...
I have a jacuzzi upstairs, or jacuzzi. It's a jacuzzi that sticks on the wall of your bathroom.
There is something to be said about a shower beer.
Yes.
There is something. Like, it's been a long time since I've had a shower beer.
So the jacuzzi solves that. Free plug for them. This is Velcroed on. So there's a suction cup.
That's sick. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, the jacuzzi.
All right, we need to put it on my wish list. Yep. Put it on the wish list.
What is this? Somehow I clicked on foam drink can holders.
Mm-hmm.
Wormholes.
I love the internet. Getting lost. I got lost 4 times in this training class I was in today. Woot.com. You ever check that out?
They used to sell all the electronic stuff.
They sell everything now. It was a deal a day.
Woot off.
Yeah, it was a deal a day originally. Now it's just like deals for crap that you don't really need. It was all made in China. But man, Woot used to be a great time waster for me.
That was when the Roomba first came out and they had a huge sale. Like, what is this?
I have one of those. I have an 880.
There was a...
And it is magical. Her name is Fifi.
Video on Reddit today, along with a knife attached to it. And he was sending it under the couch because he heard something.
Fifi!
You just see this 10-inch chef's blade. It's going under the couch. So when did you... So you got into fly fishing. When did you get into tying?
Man, not long after. To save money.
As they all say.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, as you see my... This is how I buy my bee chains.
By the case. By the 100-foot
spool.
Bee chain.
Oh, yeah. 2 sizes. But look at that. I've actually gone through one of these.
Yeah. How many flies do you think that is? 1,000? No. All right. So if it's 100 feet.
If I'm commercially tying shad flies, these I might, 300 of these a day.
Wow.
And
that's a lot.
My neighbors, before they moved to Tampa, their kids would sit here.
And cut them
with
for
the pliers.
You.
Yeah. You do it inside a Ziploc bag because they tend to ping, ping, ping.
Yeah, yeah.
You just do it inside a Ziploc bag.
That's good.
The kids with small hands get in the Ziploc bag. Put them in child labor.
Yep. I keep asking my kids, come on, man. Come on. You need to come. Listen, I'm telling you, in high school, you do not have to work at Publix or Chick-fil-A or any of these places that you talk about working, Subway, none of it. Just come upstairs. You don't even have to drive anywhere.
You have Publix where you are?
Yeah, we got Publix.
I've heard about their subs.
Let me tell you about their subs.
It's good stuff.
Can you see my face through this podcast?
Yeah.
Do you see the look?
We have some called Taylor Gourmet, but that's a restaurant, not a grocery store. I've heard.
So
their sandwiches are pretty up there.
The favorite, they do a Cuban. That's very good. But my favorite is the at Thanksgiving, they do a carved turkey with a cranberry orange relish in the sandwich, and then it's also some sort of cheese. I think it's so what's the one that starts with a G?
Gouda.
It's smoked Gouda.
Howda.
Is it Howda?
Shut up. Howda. If I only had one cheese to eat for the rest of my life, it'd be Howda. I was a cheesemonger.
Okay.
For several years.
Okay.
You could have so many types of that cheese, from soft, like melty, like aged
dry.
Parmesan
that you don't have
to refrigerate. You can get it with truffle Gouda, but you can get wasabi Gouda. You can get whiskey Gouda.
Whiskey Gouda.
Roasted garlic Gouda.
So
nice onion Gouda.
This,
it's like the shrimps with Forrest Gump.
Mama said. You can do, so smoked Gouda. Get you some spreshu. Get you some of that smoked Gouda. We have some friends that made these sandwiches they call, we have nobody watching right now. For the record, we have scared everybody off with the cheese talk. Yeah, this is stupid. I'm out.
You're missing out on cheese. I can go on about cheese for hours.
Man, I married a Wisconsinite. So, like, the first time the first time I had cheese curds, I kind of freaked out. It felt like Windex in my teeth.
Yeah, it's a texture. But we had Portuguese poutine in Montreal.
Don't curse at me. Don't curse at me.
Gosh.
So
if you've got a choice of the last meal before you get electrocuted, that might be it.
The smoked Gouda that you can take. And you put a little spray in a pan, right? And you just drop the Gouda in. And you can fry it like bacon. Okay, so
it comes in the ring.
Uh-huh.
Circular cut.
Correct.
The brown skin.
That's it. That's it. And then you flip it and you fry it like you would bacon.
Right.
In butter, preferably. It's a vegan. They call them clats. Cheese, lettuce, avocado, and sandwich. Cheese, lettuce, avocado, tomato sandwich.
I'd eat that.
It's like a BLT. But with the smoked Gouda, because the smoked Gouda has a bacony flavor.
Right.
Man,
that sounds like
good.
A sandwich I'd get.
It is super
down
good.
Down in Nashville.
Yeah,
a sandwich place we have outside
good.
Of town.
Clat. It's called a clat. That sounds filthy. Yeah, I got the clats.
Bad case of them?
Bad case of the clats. Delicious clats, even.
That sounds like something, you know, is Grandma bringing the clats to Passover?
The clats. All right, let's get these things orange. I like to do the orange face on my mullets.
You're like an impressionist. That could be put up in a postmodern art museum as some kind of the piece of paper.
Oh, yeah? Yep. A guy I went to high school with, I hope he watches. His name is Matthew Pinsky. His Instagram handle is Dupinsky, because he actually says Leonardo Dupinsky.
Okay.
Very similar artwork. And it's good. His stuff's cool, man. He fly fishes.
Right on.
I think. He's a Pacific Northwest. I haven't seen him since high school. So the Instagram is like, you know, there's a lot to conjecture there. We're going to assume that he's posted the trouts. And he's floated somewhere in Washington State. I feel like I need to, like, get it up here so people can see what I'm doing. Hey, here we go. Boom. Now we get the face.
Did you have any mentors when you started Tired Flies?
Yes. Mr. Cohen. Patrick Cohen. Took me under the wing. and kind of showed me how to pay the dues, pay the taxes.
I noticed you're using all his scissors, the green handles.
Man, they're dope. They're dope. Now you have a set, and you will also talk about them.
I will be.
And like I said, they're used, the ones I gave you. But, man, there's nothing that'll cut GSP, especially the 200 from Vivas. Nothing cuts it. I mean, you need a razor blade, but these things do.
I've showed you...
the loons. You're into those, yeah?
No, this stuff. What is this? 12-aught nano silk.
Who makes this?
Semper Fly.
Oh, yeah. That's European, right?
Yeah, look, that stuff. I mean, that stuff will.
How is it for breakage? Like hanging on it and stuff.
Knock yourself out. Probably bend the hook.
Oh yeah, that's crazy. That's GSP, dude. That's exactly what this
but
is.
Look, look how just wispy that stuff is.
Yeah, this is crazy thick compared to that. That's neat. Nano silk? What do they make it out of? Actual silk?
I have no idea.
So check this. You use Vivas 200, right?
What do I have here?
Here. But see the bulk?
What is that?
That's 200. That's it? Yeah. Yeah, that's it. That's what this is. That's all I use. So, we're done. We've been going for an hour. We'll just let it go.
One of these in your tying kit? Dental pick? For dubbing brushes?
Dab tool? Yes, dental pick. No, I don't have that.
That's pretty fantastic. That and the...
Nope, you just stuck it to your finger.
Fuck, forget it. Where's the my OPST dubbing spinner? That thing is...
I use the I don't know who makes it.
Try that. All right, give that a spin.
This thing?
Yeah.
It's just weighted? That's it?
Yep.
That's quick.
Well, hold on. Let it go. It'll just keep going and going and going.
No, it'll probably draw it straight up on it. I touched it. Wow.
That is a fantastic... That changed my dubbing game.
The one I have is on the stick, on the, and you have to spin it. It's on ball bearings, right?
Look at that thing. That's
still going. That's ridiculous.
What you are sitting in is a collection of just randomness from all over since I was in high school.
Man, you've been tying a minute, right? 20 years?
Oh, I got
25.
I got my first vice from Grizzly at Angler's Lie, spring break, 94.
Wow.
But I had just been taking flies in my hand and just, or like just hooks,
mm-hmm.
bait hooks for probably a year.
Mm-hmm.
And I would use either my parakeet's feathers or stuff. It was Spanish class, and people made these collages that were on the court walls. And I would take pipe cleaners and feathers and... But, I mean, you're going to look around. I'll see something in the craft store like this.
Yeah. I'll buy stuff like this on the regular, man. Whatever. I'll be like, I'm doing something with that.
So I've just been buying stuff from all over the place for years.
Mm-hmm.
I have something. This is a... Oh, come on. This is a Hawaiian... thing to ward off evil spirits. That's been with my fly tying material since I got it.
Really?
It was a gift from my buddy's girlfriend in college who lived in Hawaii.
That's cool. And you pulled feathers off of it to tie with?
No, I never have, did. Actually.
Okay, cool. It's a big old thing of schlopping right there.
Yeah. Well, you gotta see. By your left foot, look at those white tail feathers. Nope, keep going. That's dog stuffed animal filling. Look at those.
Look at that.
eBay, China.
Really?
White roosters. I make 12-inch long herring flies with
those.
Yeah,
dude, that's great. This is what we do in y'all.
So my bacon fly, I get the slapping wasn't good enough for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, I get rooster tails from China.
Yeah.
And this is what I use as the hackle.
That's schlopping, man. That's all just schlopping.
Big cocktail.
Black schlopping.
Basically, big feather duster.
Yeah.
But just
look at the webbing, dude.
The oily iridescence to them.
That's sick.
Do I need to tie you one of these for you to take home?
What is it? What are you going to do?
My bacon fly.
Yes, you definitely do. Especially if you caught a big fatty.
It's the only streamer I'll use.
Here we go. For sure. Trout.
Flash is in front of me.
Bacon fly.
Everything is bacon. I do too now. I never cooked bacon till a steelhead trip a couple years ago. So this fly, you're going to do that back. Do a tungsten cone. Hmm. And then I'm going to use non-toxic.
Do you like that vise?
I love the Regal. Yeah. It is just so easy.
Yeah, it's just clip, clip, done.
It hurts though when I'm commercially tying shad flies, opening and closing that.
I can imagine.
Almost every 40 seconds.
Yep.
Is just painful.
You haven't had it break or anything, right?
No. I've worn it so much that I've got to put a little WD-40 on the inside of it.
Yeah.
All right. So then, after years, I decided I need a little bit of flash because the fly is so black. So I put a pinch of this flashaboo underneath. I should probably start my thread. So the great thing about my flies, they only take a couple seconds to dry.
Yeah, it is.
And when I go out to my in-law's place in Colorado, I will take pretty much just a box of these.
Yeah.
I've got that much confidence. Single hook?
Yeah.
I've tied them articulated. I lost about a...
Is this solder?
Yeah.
Get out of here.
And it fits right on there, and it fits exactly on
there. And it's heavy enough.
Yeah, it helps get everything down.
How about that? Oh, the places you'll go.
Got a couple hacks. Like when I was doing the steelhead, how to prepare for steelhead trip talk the other day at my TU chapter. I said, when you're going out in the morning, if you got time, make hard-boiled eggs. If you put a freshly hot hard-boiled egg in your jacket pocket, it'll stay hot for about an hour and a half.
Huh.
You can put your paws in there and warm them up. I've got a couple hacks up my sleeve.
That's a good one.
Man, this thing is just, it's big and beefy and it darts around. And I suggest people fish this with a loop knot and at least three BB split shot in front of it.
Mm-hmm.
And this thing on a plunge pool out in Colorado was with the dropper.
Drops, huh?
Yeah, just right in that fast water.
Yep.
There's no time for using sink tips and other things.
That was the biggest thing I noticed. I was out there a couple of months, maybe a month ago, and was fishing. We floated the Blue River.
Yeah.
And
below,
below the green mountain reservoir.
Okay.
Floated through private water, the Jones Ranch, and all that crap.
Oh, Jurassic Park.
Yeah, that's where we were.
Yep. My goodness.
And I was fishing a 7-weight with sink tip.
You could have hung out and drank vodka with my father-in-law.
And I could not get deep enough with a sink tip line, and a standard streamer.
Oop, I just poked the mic. Yeah, this thing, you hit a plunge pool, and it's made just to sink right in there, pop, pop, and I'm on. And the podcast listeners will know that. I'll take this out to Colorado, and I will fish downstream from the guides, and their nymph rigging little jujubatus,
yeah,
size 22s,
yeah,
yeah, yeah, with a size of sand grain split shot under indicator, and they're not catching jack, and I go right behind them, and I rip this through.
And they just destroy it. Oh, she wrote.
That's how much confidence. I don't fish it. Well, I've never caught a steelhead on it, but that's the only other type of trout I fish for. But this thing in Idaho was absolutely nuts. And I have no idea the stream name. And I was sworn to secrecy even if I did.
Mm-hmm. Those are the best spots. I go back in there and be like, what did you do last night? Look at your hand.
Are you breathing okay?
Are you feel all right? Yeah, blood flow issues, man. I don't know. Feel great.
And at the time that I came up with this, this was considered, like in our fly shop that I worked at, this was considered like a way huge streamer.
Really?
Back then, a muddler was big.
Hmm.
You know, like a size 4 woolly bugger was a big fly for trout.
Really?
This is, and before articulation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or that's, at least commercially articulation.
Yeah.
People have been articulating since the 90s. That's crazy.
That's the bacon fly.
The bacon fly.
Man, the turkey tonight was cooked in bacon grease.
That's good, man. Mayonnaise. Chewy
sauce.
Chewy's.
It's a Tex-Mex restaurant.
Oh, no. We have one in Murfreesboro. It's delicious.
Yeah, it's the white sauce.
It's so good.
It's 50 mayonnaise, 50 sour cream.
Mm.
Hold all the cilantro.
Chewy's.
Dig me the Chewy's.
I will fish this, brother.
So here's the thing. Reach over you.
No, you're fine.
This is the stencil I use for my ultra suede tails for my bass worms.
Nice.
I was in the craft store. It's for like smearing paint.
Schmearing.
And I was like, that's it.
Want it.
I found this in a parking lot. I thought this was going to be it. Do you know how hard it is to find isosceles triangular stencil? I found this in a parking lot at a petting zoo in a ski resort town. I was like, that's my stencil.
What is this?
I don't know.
It's part of jewelry. It's just for jewelry.
So I was tying my bass worms with that as the tail.
The secret is out.
Just show them the other side.
Go find your jewelry in a parking lot. Idaho is the spot.
No, Massanutten, Virginia.
I wasn't listening.
Oh.
Virginia. You're like, no. That's not even close.
That was a afternoon at a water park, and that's when you realize you really don't like being in public with people in swimsuits. And
yeah, like a ginormous kiddie pool.
Yeah.
Everyone uses the bathroom.
And my fear of some things is just reinforced going on an inner tube in a completely black
water slide. Dude, I can't handle that. I can't breathe when I get in those tubes.
And then you just
like
drop 10 feet, but you
don't
know
you're
doing it.
I can't breathe.
I almost died of a heart attack on Space Mountain in Florida a couple years ago.
It's not for me. The dark? No, I don't do it.
What else is bizarre, weird in here that I can share?
I'm digging the shoe rack.
For my reels.
For the reels.
Those
wall-mounted shoe rack as seen on TV.
There's probably not a reel in there that's
reels.
Newer than
Let me get 99. Let me get you guys to see this. This is how we do reels here. We do it. There's like 40 reels over there.
They're all so old, but the fish haven't changed.
No, they haven't. That's the thing, man. You know, I'm going to do a plug for Clutch for a second, and here's why. The first time I met Lee Janik was at one of the Asheville show,
right,
where I met you. And, or was the second time we met. And Lee explained something to me about their rods and the fact that, because they don't have the overhead of the bigger companies like an IT department, an HR department, sales team, support staff, et cetera, executive staff, keep going, you know, I just named it 2 dozen people.
Right, that's a lot of money.
You got to pay for, right? So, and other rods companies are fine. This is just who I've chosen to deal with, and I like the small companies. I like that kind of mentality. But they were talking about how they're not going to come out with a new rod every 6 months or every year or every season.
Just to come out with a new rod.
Because these other companies, at the end of the day, really, there's only so many ways you can roll graphite. There's only so many tapers you can do.
It's like someone trying to sell me a new spoon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, well, so...
Like the spork was revolutionary, but...
Right, right.
Well, there is the fork chopstick. But yes.
But to Lee's point, he was trying to say, he's like, dude, we have a handful of rods that work really well.
Right.
We don't need
what we're targeting them has not changed.
Correct. Like, it's they cast wonderfully. You know, the lines, they work well with line. This, they have a goal in mind. This, that's ridiculous. I need that in my life. That's a camping. That's.
That one's broken, it looks like. No.
No, that's two separate. That's a knife fork. That is also...
Dude, that looks like hedge trimmers.
We are blowing our minds.
Y'all are missing out.
Yeah, y'all. No one knows. We're looking at forks and...
Do you do Korean food at all?
Yeah. Did we just become best friends? Well, did that just happen?
If you go about 3 miles...
I've read all the Korean church open... You know, all the signs on the churches and stuff.
I'm
going
to send you to
here.
Sorak Garden after this.
I even came through here and I was like, four places. And I was like, I like pho. And then I started seeing Korean writing and I was like...
Yishan.
That is, dude, bulgogi or dosa, bibimbap, that is my jam. Yishan,
it is, how far? 4.2 miles, 11 minutes this time of night.
Are they open?
You've got to wait in line at 3 in the morning.
Shut up.
Yeah.
At a Korean place.
Yeah.
It's that good.
The entire neighborhood where I used to live was all Korean.
Yeah.
There was a Burger King and a Wendy's. That was the only place if you wanted to get a burger.
Yeah.
We did have the Ilmi Buffet. We had the Cow Dung Day Spa.
Mm.
We had a fantastic Afghan kebab place, which I'll still drive to.
So when previous company I worked at, we did a lot of installed live sound systems. Like, so we did big churches, big auditoriums, you know, stuff like that. And this one gig we did was in Madison, Wisconsin, at a Lutheran church that was over 150 years old. Need a new sound system. Well, the guy I worked under, the lead, I went to college with him, and he was Korean. His name was Jae-jin. He went by Jacob, but Jae-jin Park was his name. And we would get corporate apartments, so we'd be in an apartment for 10 days straight. And we, you know, it was two guys to an apartment, and then he and I would go to the Korean restaurant. We would try to find the local Korean grocery store. Well, in Madison, there's one.
Keep talking.
There's one. Well, next door, like, he starts asking the girl working there, who's clearly Korean, like, where do I go for food? Where's the restaurants? Is there one? And she's like, well, yeah, it's next door.
This is all from the Korean grocery store.
All from the Korean grocery store, right?
This.
That is. Look at this. This is freaking, cactus chenille, man.
$6 a skein.
That's insane. That's all the cactus chenille you should ever need. That's great.
They're for making your own loofahs.
Loofahs?
Yeah.
Really? How about that?
Oh, yeah, we've got a lot of Korean groceries. Yes, Annandale's down the street.
That's yours.
Have you ever had Korean fried chicken?
Yes.
See, look at that. How hard... Yeah.
Yeah, you know, dude, cut this with the pat scissors. Here.
Oh, okay.
Try that out. Nah, tight.
Yeah.
Yeah, ridiculous.
Butter.
Uh-huh. All right, so back to the Madison, Wisconsin. We're going to the grocery store. I think my phone's going to die. I'm actually going to hop off here. So you got, who is that that sounds like T.J. Miller from Deadpool?
But next you're going to say I look like the Wet Bandit from Home Alone.
T.J. Miller, y'all. T.J. Miller in the house.
No way. Let me put my
phone up. All right, I got to go. See you guys. Thanks, Instagram. Oh, that's hilarious.
T.J. Miller. I just watched Deadpool 2 last night.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Let's see if there's any shrimp out.
All right, so...
I got shrimp in there that are this big.
Really? They look like fleas, I bet.
Oh, yeah, they're so fast. Everything else is dead.
Oh, man, it's
all
too bad.
All the caddis and stoneflies. Well, they all ended up hatching.
But that it's too warm or what? Not enough oxygen?
No. And then my mosquito fish gave live birth and they ate them all.
My daughter insisted on getting a goldfish at the fall festival last year. And I said no. Not just no, but hell no, because we're not going to raise a goldfish in our home. We have dogs. That's the family we are. She got it anyway.
I can finish this fly.
She got it anyway, and we have this old frog pond that's next door to our porch the previous owner made, and then, like, the pump...
Your mosquito...
No, there's mosquito fish in it, and they all eat all the mosquito larvae, so that was good.
Right on. I love me mosquito fish.
And it's loaded with tadpoles and loaded with frogs. Absolutely loaded. Lotus plants all in it and everything.
This is a simple streamer, man.
Oh, I bet.
Popsicle.
She's like, I'm going to keep it. I want to keep this fish. I want to keep the goldfish. I was like, okay, fine. But I'm not buying an aquarium, and you're going to have to put it in the pond out back. And it's probably not going to live. I just was honest. It's probably not going to live. So we did it. We put it in. It was like September. We didn't think anything about it.
It's now driving.
Winter came. And that pond froze pretty solid. Like the whole thing. Because it's only like this deep, dude. It's a garden pond, you know? It's a stupid koi pond. Maybe the size of your table. It's really not that big. This past spring... I'm just kind of like hanging out in the back porch, and I see an orange flash, and that stupid fish is still alive.
Yeah, they convert sugars in their body to alcohol into their blood so they don't freeze over winter.
Get out of here.
Yeah, man.
So now that goldfish is about this big. He's about
what's his
the size
name?
Of a cheddar.
You're so Wisconsin.
His name is Cheddar. He's still alive, man, and he's gotten big enough now that there's not enough oxygen in the water. He has to come up and sip air, so he's probably not going to live much longer, I'd say. He's going to get bigger, and that's probably going to be enough.
We got some big goldfish in the Potomac.
Dude, they're huge.
Like that big. So I finally found another piece of marabou to finish this off.
The popsicle?
Yeah. That's what Thomas catches all of his steelhead on up in New York.
Nice.
It's a great striper fly for down here.
Who did your...
That's Joseph Tomilleri.
Who dat? New phone.
Joseph Tomilleri, he did all these trout paintings. Here, they're all hand-signed.
Yeah.
When I worked at Orvis. And then that's a Dave Whitlock original.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
Which is a print that's signed. And then there's one in my daughter's room of a bluegill.
Nice.
That Dave Whitlock signed for her. But out there is a rainbow trout print. They got it all places Target by a woman named, I think, Marie Klatt. Klatt.
We are talking about Klatts.
There you go.
Good sound.
And it was rainbows, brook trout, cutthroat, and golden trout. And I had this arrogance that I couldn't hang one up if I hadn't caught it yet. And I should have just bought them all to put them in storage.
Yep. I can't even own it.
Yeah.
Not until it's tasted my steel.
It took me a while to get into trout. I used to spend all my weekends
up
in the mountains.
I'll tell you, dude, I can give two rips about trout. I'm not into them. I started doing it, you know, with the whole nymph game, and the first time I ever tried streamer fishing, first of all, I couldn't cast to save my life. We were fishing for hybrid bass.
The wipers?
On Percy Priest Lake. In November, and that's when the seagulls come in to Tennessee, and the shad get pushed up on the top.
The gizzards?
Dude, I don't know.
Ugh.
It's ridiculous.
Gizzards
it's disgusting. Like somebody's throwing grenades all around the boat. They're just blowing up like they do in the ocean, you know? It's just so cool. And there's seagulls everywhere. It's the whole thing is true, you know, find the birds, find the fish.
Right.
That's how we play it, and it's fun. I haven't done that in a while. I need to do that this year. Got a new boat, dude. Let's talk about the boat.
Yeah.
I have a new boat. You haven't even seen pictures of it.
But this
is called...
I'm sorry to get in the mood of the Steely, so tie that today.
Oh, yeah. Those are fun.
Little pink intruder.
So the boat is called a Santee. They're made in Greenville, South Carolina, where I was born. They have one hull model. This is us and the kids. That's my kids over there in the corner. There it is. It's a kind of good idea of how big it is.
What are you targeting with that boat?
Man, what do you want to do? So we can take it for stripers in the lake, stripers in the river. We can do carp. I've done carp mostly because I'm breaking in the motor. So I'll take it on the lake and run it, and then I'll go into the coves and fish a little bit, and then go back out and run the motor for an hour or so. It drafts in, now their specs say it'll draft in, I don't want to say it wrong, I want to say 6 inches, but dude, I've had it in 2. And I wasn't in it, but it'll float in nothing. The chines don't even go underwater. Like when it's,
so I can tell my boat level when the chironomids skins stack up on it, there's a level.
Oh, really?
I've got so many chironomids on it from lakes.
You can see the chines aren't even under the water, dude. Like, the way to the side, they're not even under
it's
the
pretty
water.
Pretty spacious inside there, too.
Almost 5 feet wide, 58 inches.
Are you pulling that?
You can.
The oars?
They have a polling platform.
You want to buy some oars?
Perhaps.
$250 for 2 Sawyer lights right now. Wood.
No, I don't want wood. I want composite. It's too heavy.
Darn it.
Dude, the boat weighs 350 pounds light, you know, just the hull. I can get by myself and break in at half throttle.
Do your fingers look dead.
They
look like you just got off of Everest.
Yeah, dude, I'm cold.
You look like Beck Weathers.
I think it's the Hulk. It's the Hulk coming through. The green and the black. Yep, it's the inner struggle. back to the boat. I did half throttle. I was getting 27 by myself, which is plenty fast for a little skiff like that. Yeah, here we go.
My stealth craft is rated 40.
There it is.
That's pretty awesome.
It's
a nice trolling motor too.
It there's no bow rise. It's just on plane, like it just lifts. You know what I'm saying? Like it just like it's on a pillow.
My old drift boat was you couldn't see out the front.
Oh, really?
It would almost went vertical.
It would just plow.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, it would plow.
That was one that got hit by the drunk driver.
Mm.
Just parked on the street in Koreatown.
Well, how long you had that stealth craft?
Hey, Dr. Jones. Since 2014.
You don't have a motor on it, though.
9.9.
You do?
It's in the back of the garage, locked up. And a trolling motor.
You need a jet on it.
I would love to have a motor, but the weight taken on and off, depending on where you're fishing around here.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not the strongest person.
And
my wife sure as hell is not going to lift it up. She's going to be like, I'm not wasting my energy on you.
No, I'm not coming
for you. She does like one-arm push-ups, but she's not wasting her energy lifting up.
Dude, my wife's a beast. My wife is a beast. She can't do one-arm push-ups, but she is getting her trainer's certification because she's currently a teacher and does not want to be anymore.
That's why I left.
Yeah. You were a teacher.
Yeah, high school biology.
Get out.
Yeah, you want to talk about...
Dude, my wife's a second grade teacher, and...
What's my daughter's in?
I can't... I don't know how much I can say, because we're on broadcast mode and all. It's not positive, you know? That's all. Man, teachers these days get a rough... It ain't right, man. That's all. That's all I'm saying.
Yep.
This whatever they're given today, it's not right. I mean, any day. Even when we were kids, man, the teachers didn't get a good break. And my wife has always said, I just wanted to be a teacher from day one. I love teaching. I love kids. And she comes home, man, she's just miserable because she's having to do things that aren't right. You know, it's not in the best interest of the kid, of the student. And there's nothing she can do about it because that's what people above her dictating what she has to do. I didn't mean to turn into that. I just, I live with a teacher and it sucks because my wife in the summer is a different person from the wife in the winter and the fall and the spring.
Margarita mom.
My summer wife is my favorite of all my wives. yeah, no, I didn't mean to get into that. It just, man,
That's why I left teaching.
It sucks, dude.
It's not what I signed up for.
I was going to be a band director when I went to school. I studied music.
You got to be my neighbor.
Yeah, I played trumpet.
He's the Army band director.
Is he really the Army band director?
Yeah, he does like the Rose Bowl.
Wow.
Inauguration.
That's sick.
July 4th.
Wow.
What up, Derek?
Hey, Derek. Yeah, man, I was going to be a band director. I went to school, went to Furman for 2 years to study trumpet and music. And I was like, wait a minute. I'm only going to make how much a year? Nah. This ain't going to work.
I prefer teaching fishing. Now, so what is your favorite species to target when you get a chance to fish? You spend a lot of time tying?
Yeah. More time.
How often do you get? I never get to fish.
I never get to fish either.
What are you going after for if you got a day off?
Man, here lately it's been carp with the boat, but before that would be striped bass. Middle Tennessee's got a couple of jewels. Well, the Cumberland River, first of all, is loaded with them, and they push up into certain places in the summer because the water's colder, and they chase the bait up in there, and then they just live there in the summer. And these things can be 50, 60 inches long on the big. Now, that's not every time.
Right.
You know, you see a lot of what they call schoolies and a lot of 30s. And catching a 30 is still fun.
Oh, I'm fine with a 30.
It'll beat you up, dude. Whenever I go striper fishing and I catch one, I come home with bruises on my side and my abdomen from jamming the rod in trying to fight them. Because you got to kick their ass.
I can imagine.
Like it's a small place. It's not a big river. It's not a big area. And so there's plenty of structures that they can run into. And you can't let them, you can't do your typical, let's let them run and wear them out. No, you have to kick their ass.
See, I would have to update my reels over there if I was doing that kind of
fishing. Oh, yeah, dude. Like you got to have something that can handle, you know, tarpon.
Yeah. What are you getting your carp on?
I use a fly called the Gorilla Salad.
Gorilla salad.
That I created, and it's so simple, man. It's essentially a super bugger, but on a small scale, and I use fox instead of marabou, right?
I'm going to show you a really cool fly. Keep talking.
No, you're good. I use the Gamakatsu bonefish hook, dumbbell, tungsten bead, or eyes, or whatever, and then Cohen's carp dubbing, because it's got the little rubber legs in it, you know? Yep. The tail is fox, and then it's got a grizzly marabou overwing. Well, look at all these freaking dry flies. What is this? There's 1,000 humpies in here, dude.
Yeah, it was the old orbit.
There's 1,000 white humpies in here.
What am I looking for?
Carp flies. Some sort of carp fly that's tied with fox.
Travis Beta Bugger.
I said Super Bugger. I mean, this is an eBay store, dude.
Yeah. I probably paid $7 for all of that.
That's crazy. Close out.
So, these are dye-injected rubber poppers from back in the day. These were the best before Flyman came out with theirs.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
I am looking for...
Look at that. How come they're so squishy like that?
Dye-injected rubber. Those were the best.
Dye-injected rubber. Look at that.
Take that one with you.
Okay. Dude, it's like a silicone rope.
Orvis curly tail. Like, this was a big fly back in the day. This is an Orvis Matuka.
I remember those. Yeah. The Matukas.
All right. It's not in here.
That's crazy. How did they get it to taper?
So nobody wanted to pick up the guy's business, so he went out.
Oh, wow, you can squeeze stuff out of it. No, you can't. I'm making that up. The guy, what? Went out of business? Because
nobody wanted to commercially pick him up, so he's like, all right.
Fuck it.
We're just going to, like, die with him.
I want to know how they got the taper. That's wild. Dye injected foam. Never thought I'd hear about that.
All right, what else before I cut off recording? What else should we talk about?
Man, I don't know. I do want to say some. Go get a Santee boat, man. Those are sweet boats.
I
Just saw my bag of buggers today.
Hold on.
You're good. We're getting dead air. I'm not really a singer.
So. All right, hold on. So when I teach a woolly bugger class, I have like every kind in a bag.
Mm-hmm.
This. Orvis Travis Beetlebugger. That thing looks like a moth got to it. That, back in the day, was...
Is that silk? I mean, silk... What is it? The straw? Oh, my God. What do they call that? What's the legs? Isn't that straw legs? No, that's rubber. I'm
blanking on it. My God, that thing... That, back when I used to fish in Pennsylvania on the weekends, like every Saturday.
Like nymphing for trout or stripping for bass? Both.
Travis Beetlebugger.
That's fun.
So simple.
Beetlebugger.
Never figured out who Travis was from Orvis. All right, what else are we going to talk about?
Man, I'm not sure. We're getting kind of low, aren't we, here?
Yeah. Where can people follow you online?
Man, always on Instagram, at Looperflies, Facebook at Looperflies, the website, www.looper-flies.mybigcommerce.com.
Favorite Harrison Ford movie?
Patriot Games.
If you had a superhero power to make you a better angler, what would it be?
Man, I want Wolverine claws. I'm sorry, dude.
Adamantium's
pretty good. I want Wolverine claws, dude. I'm good. I'd be like the bear, just waiting for the salmon to run upstream. Snickety-snicked.
Best sandwich after fishing?
Peanut butter jelly.
Where's your favorite place? Where's your favorite hot chicken?
I mean, I like it. Honestly, I do the Chick-fil-A spicy chicken sandwich a good bit. Hattie B's is so far away. And then the bastardization of Hattie B's in Murfreesboro of whatever they is not a real thing.
Holy pepper something. Pepper fire.
I honestly haven't even had Hattie B's because it's too trendy for me.
That's the one across from from
Fly South.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Which is a killer store.
Yeah, there's some stuff in there.
They got a cool
And
place.
I saw your flies at
Jones
Fly Company.
They shut down, man.
Really?
Sure did. Closed up about 2 months ago.
That's why I haven't seen any updates.
Yep. Call it a day, man.
Oh, man. I would love to know what he's doing now.
We'll talk about it.
All right.
Mm-hmm. We can talk. This is for me.
Sorry, I ruined that one.
No.
Do you want another whitehead?
No, I got plenty, dude.
All right. Okay. Well, let's sign off from there.
Yeah. Thanks for the whiteheads.
Thank you for joining us for the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. For more information or to contact Rob, please go to www.robsnowwhite.com.
Media.